It was left at the coffee bar. I don't want you getting too far away before you realize you lost your phone this morning. Ah! There you go. That was before you got coffee. You're good to go now. Oh, good morning. I know there were a couple of guys that are so faithful that they were here last week. I'm not going to say who he is, but I know that there were maybe two or three that showed up last week. I apologize for that. If you are not on the email list, if you are not getting weekly emails, please check your name where you sign in to be sure that your email address is right. And if you're not getting the email, please let one of us know so we can be sure that you're on the list and you do get the emails and updates if our schedule changes or we have some kind of special event, which is very rare. We're thankful that C-Spire hosted us, and they had an event last week that precluded us from meeting here. Mr. Creekmore's going to be sure that doesn't happen anymore, so we thank him for that. Guys, I hope y'all all had a wonderful Easter weekend in celebrating our risen Christ. He is the reason we're here, and let us go to him for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your son, for his place on the cross, Lord, and his risen self on Sunday, bridging the gap between us and you, bridging the sin that wages here in this world, Lord, that we're subject to every day. We ask that you forgive us of our sins. We thank you for your son. In his name we pray. Amen.
Excited to be here this morning. After 10 years, we took a break last week. We've been meeting for 10 years coming up in August and have never missed a Thursday other than a holiday that we chose not to meet or a weather hiccup. And so, 10 years from now, we'll take another break, but I don't ever want to take a break again. So every 10 years, we take one break. Glad you're here this morning. I have a song for you that I trust will awaken your heart to what the Lord has for us. What do you do when you don't know what to do? Where do you go when you don't feel like you have any place to go? You know, it's easy when things are easy, but what do you do when it's hard? I want to just read the lines to this song, the first few lines of this song, Even If, by Mercy Me, a brand new song by Mercy Me that's fabulous. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand, but even if you don't, my hope is you alone. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Good thing. A little faith is all I have right now. But God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, give me the strength to be able to sing, It Is Well With My Soul. I know you're able, and I know you can. Hope this will open your heart to what God has for us this morning. May you hear the voice of God.
They say sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some. And right now, I'm losing bad. I've stood on this stage night after night, reminding the broken it'll be all right. But right now, I just can't. It's easy to say when there's nothing to bring me down. But what will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand, but even if you don't, my hope is you alone. They say it only takes a little faith to move a mountain. Well, good thing a little faith is all I have right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, oh, give me the strength to be able to sing. It is well with my soul. I know you're able, and I know you can see through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow, and I know the hurt would all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. You've been faithful, you've been good all of my days. Jesus, I will cling to you, come what may, 'cause I know you're able, I know you can.
Stand firm in your faith. Act like men. Be strong. The words from 1 Corinthians 16:13. We continue our series on the adventure of intimacy. Knowing and being known. Somebody sent out an email the other day. Know any good books about the topic of knowing and being known? I need to read a good book on that. And I was so glad to see in the email chain, somebody said, Phil Hardin's written a book on that. Check Phil's book out. It's good. So if you haven't read my book, there's copies in the back. I'll sell you one. I'll even autograph it for you. But it's the idea of knowing and being known, intimacy. You to follow with me as we read the introductory paragraph. We hadn't read this in a while. Kind of the summary of this series that we've been working with for several weeks. The adventure of intimacy. Prayer is the experience of intimacy. Every man believes in prayer in some form, whether a cry of desperation in a foxhole or the true expression of a heart focused on worship. Prayer is a connection of intimacy and becomes the means of experiencing the awe of God. Intimacy is the deep longing of every man, and yet so many men suffer from the inability to attain truth, respect, and lasting love in their relationships. This series will explore how to experience true intimacy and trusting love with God and in your most important relationships. And I appreciate the comments that I've gotten through this series that God's been speaking to your heart about this idea of intimacy. And this morning, what I want to cover is just what I would call critical signposts along the journey of intimacy. Critical things that you've got to keep in mind. So I want you to pick up your pen and work with me here for a minute and deliberately engage this morning. So I have three questions for you. First question, I just want you to write relationship. Relationship. And the question that's connected to relationship, what do you offer? What do you offer in relationships? When somebody walks into your presence, whether it's your wife, your son, your daughter, or a friend, what do you offer? If you were thinking consciously of the desire to connect with them, what would you offer? I think it's very important to have that in mind. Those of you who have been to our men's coaching weekend, deer camp, fish camp in Fairhope, what we wear out is one word that whole weekend. And the word is welcome. Welcome. Glad you're here. Welcome. Glad you're here. I mean, we just hammer it. There's with no apologies for repeating ourselves over and over. Glad you're here. Welcome. When you walk into my presence, I want you to feel welcomed. I try to live that way. I've got a lot of growing to do, and I'm not nearly as good at it as I wish I was. But when you shake my hand, I'm going to do my best to look you in the eye and welcome you in to my little presence. I once did counseling with a young guy who had been thrown back and forth in foster home. One of my favorite stories. He, you know, it was just a sad story, no fault of his. He was just thrown from foster home to foster home. And I'm an intern, a counselor wannabe, and I'm seeing him. And, you know, pretty quickly, I got the idea that it wasn't about counseling, whatever that is, per se. It was just about making a connection with him. And for a couple of sessions, you know what I worked with him on? I just worked with him on how to shake somebody's hand. And that's what we'd work on, you know. And he would get across the little counseling room we were in, and I'd get on the other side, and I'd say, okay, now, walk toward me. Hey, Bob, good to see you, man. You know, make eye contact. Just helping him to learn to look into somebody's eyes. I wanted him to feel welcomed by me and learn how to welcome somebody into his presence. Relationship. What do you offer? I sat with a man recently, and his wife was sitting on the love seat in my office, and he was sitting in another chair across from her. And I asked him, I said, what do you think your wife feels when she walks in to your presence? And I look over his wife. I just asked, you know, I'm just curious. I just asked the question. She starts crying. I mean, just at that, she starts crying. And I'm thinking, oh, my goodness, Bubba's in trouble. Bubba's in trouble. Second question. Where do you fail? Relationship. Where do you fail? Where do you fail? And I'll tell you that my friend Bubba that I was just talking about, I'll tell you where he fails, and he knows it. He's getting it. Where he fails is he carries anger around with him. You can smell it. You can feel it. He's just an angry guy. And his wife feels abused. Where do you fail? I really believe a little Eastern mysticism. I believe that when you walk into my presence and when I walk into your presence, I feel an energy. Larry Crabb, Christian counselor, is the first one that ever alerted me to this. I remember him saying in a lecture hall at Westminster Seminary in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, years ago, he said, "I'm always aware of what I feel when I walk into somebody's presence, and I'm always thinking about what they feel when they walk into my presence." Do people feel negative energy from you or positive energy? Where do you fail? It may be a lot of negative energy. It's there. It's there. Final question, third question. What boundaries do you need to set to make relationships work better? I'm a strong believer that learning how to set boundaries is critical to having healthy relationships. So I'm asking you, what boundaries do you need to set right now? One boundary might be just for your own self, that I need to put the clicker down and turn ESPN off when my wife is talking to me. That might be a good boundary. I need to look my wife in the eyes. Might be a good personal boundary. I might need to say no to all those phone calls that are coming in that distract me and keep me from talking to those that I love. I may need to say no to my teenagers. What boundaries? Because I really believe that in order to be good relationally and therefore good in exercising intimacy, that boundaries are always in play. I need to be saying yes and saying no. Yes to the good and no to the bad. And I need to be working with that consciously all the time. Boundaries, boundaries, boundaries. You never get to take a break from boundaries. Okay? Now, those are your three questions that you're going to work with today. Critical signs. I want you to understand the gospel this morning. But first, let's draw the playing field for intimacy. Just quickly, find you a spot on your notes. Draw the rectangular football field-like rectangle. It is called intimacy. And as we've been working with this whole series, intimacy, first of all, is you've got to get the spiritual part of your life, the God piece of your life, as the cornerstone of the playing field. Intimacy starts with God, knowing God and being known by Him. That's what Scripture says is even the definition of eternal life, knowing God and Him knowing you throughout eternity. And then the second piece is self-awareness. Self-aware. That I need to know what's going on with me rather than projecting all the negative energy in me on somebody else. What's really going on with you? And then the third piece is respect for other. And we call that empathy. That I can really understand where the other person's coming from, even if I disagree with them. I mean, I may think that's the silliest thing I've ever heard, what they're saying. But at least I can respect what they're saying. And from their view, that's what they believe. Okay, that's cool. I respect you. I don't have to have your approval of me, or I hope you don't have to have my approval of you in order to live life. And then finally is this idea of boundaries. That's the playing field. Okay? Now, I want you to understand the gospel this morning as best as I can communicate it. And there's so many wonderful ways that God gives us to understand the gospel. But in the gospel, which is beginning, to anchor this idea of our prayer life and intimate connection with God into this journey of into intimacy, is what you've got to understand is the tension between love and justice. And that is what the gospel is about. Love and justice. Love and justice. Turn over to Nehemiah. chapter 9. Nehemiah chapter 9 details how when they finished the wall, and we looked at that several months ago, that they stood and they honored God by reading his word. In fact, the early part of Nehemiah 9 says, for 6 hours they stood and they read God's word. 6 hours. How long would you last? You know, I got to go to the bathroom after about 6 minutes, you know. 6 hours. They just read God's word. And then it says for 6 hours, they confessed their sins to one another. In newspaper English language, they just told their story to each other for 6 hours. And then it gets along that starts to get into the real journey of life. I want you to listen to this. Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 16. But they, our ancestors, were arrogant, bullheaded. They wouldn't obey your commands. They turned a deaf ear. They refused to remember the miracles you had done for them. They turned stubborn, got it into their heads to return to their Egyptian slavery. And you, a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, incredibly patient with tons of love, you didn't dump them. Now, guys, that is the gospel. This is the beginning of the gospel. Stubborn, arrogant, wanting to return to your old ways. And it just says, and God, deep in grace, deep in compassion, stayed with them and hung on to them. Yes, even when they cast a sculpted calf and said, this is your God who brought you out of Egypt and continued from bad to worse, you and your amazing compassion didn't walk off and leave them in the desert. Even when you're into your addiction would be the contemporary way to understand that. I would doubt that anybody in this room has sculpted a golden calf and put it in your front yard. That would be pretty weird. That would be a fraternity house. Yeah, that's right. That would be Animal House for sure. But you and I both know that you love cheese pizzas way too much. And you order cheese pizzas at 2 a.m. in the morning, and you're into your cheese pizzas, whatever addiction that is. And God keeps wooing and pursuing. He never lets up. The pillar of cloud didn't leave them. Daily, it continued to show them their route. The pillar of fire did the same by night, showed them the right way to go. You gave them your good spirit to teach them to live wisely. You never stinted with your manna, gave them plenty of water to drink. You supported them 40 years in that desert. They had everything they needed. Their clothes didn't wear out and their feet never blistered. Isn't that interesting? You know, again, we have this 40 years of wilderness writings, and God provided for them all along, but he never took them out of the wilderness. Does that sound familiar to you? Is that kind of like your life? You've got that thing going on, and boy, you wish God would take that out. But he says, no, I'm going to kind of do you with that circumstance in your life the way that I did the children of Israel when I left them in the wilderness for 40 years, and I provided for them, but I didn't take them out of the difficult circumstance. Wow. I get it. Now, the gospel, love and justice. I want you to obey me. I love you and accept you. I want you to obey me. I love you and accept me. The tension between love and justice, which is more important, the love of God or the obedience on my part? Well, they're both really important. I got to figure out that tension. Turn over to Exodus 34. Exodus 34, very early on, God presents this same tension. Exodus 34 says this, starting with verse 4. So Moses cut 2 tablets of stone, just like the originals. He got up early in the morning and climbed Mount Sinai as God had commanded him, carrying the 2 tablets of stone. I actually saw this Saturday night. I watched part of the Ten Commandments. Anybody see the Ten Commandments on TV the other night? It's pretty cool. I hadn't seen it in a long time. God descended in the cloud and took up his position there beside him and called out the name God. And God passed in front of him and called out, God, God, a God of mercy and grace, endlessly patient, so much love, so deeply true, loyal in love for 1,000 generations, forgiving iniquity, rebellion, and sin. Wow. Thank you, Lord. The love of God. But it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop there. It's this tension. Listen to this part. Still, he doesn't ignore sin. He holds sons and grandsons responsible for father's sins to the third and even the fourth generation. Doesn't it bring you pain to consider that what you do in a sinful way would actually be experienced as consequence to your sin by your children or your grandchildren or your great-grandchildren? That scares me to death. You have to be a pretty hard-hearted guy to do something and not care about children and grandchildren. And that's what the scripture says. You know, David was a guy, was a man after God's own heart, and he sinned and God forgave him. And yet, you know who experienced the consequences of his sin? His sons and his grandsons. Read the scripture. Wow, what a train wreck. What a train wreck. Again, the gospel, the love of God, the forgiving hound of heaven pursuing you, and yet the demand, the requirement of holiness be met, and the responsibility and the consequence of sin is always in play. How do you deal with that tension? Is it you or is it God? Look at Psalm 130. Again, these passages, of course, are on the back of your notes. Psalm 130. Psalm 130, starting with verse 1, and then I'll get down to 3 and 4. Help, God, the bottom has fallen out of my life. Master, hear my cry for help. Listen hard. Open your ears. Listen to my cries for mercy. And then verse 3, if you, God, kept records on wrongdoings, who would stand a chance? As it turns out, forgiveness is your habit, and that's why you're worshipped. Again, the forgiving, long-suffering nature of God. Thank you, God. I'm so glad that it's not all up to me. It's not about what I do or don't do. Kinda. It is kinda. I'm responsible. I need to meet the requirement of holiness, but God provides. God provides. How do you deal with the tension between God's forgiveness and also his requirement that holiness be honored? Look at Micah chapter 7. Micah chapter 7, verses 18. Where is the God who can compare with you, wiping the slate clean of guilt, turning a blind eye, a deaf ear to the past sins of your purged and precious people? You don't nurse your anger and don't stay angry long, for mercy is your specialty. That's what you love most. And compassion is on its way to us. You'll stamp out our wrongdoing. You'll sink our sins to the bottom of the ocean. You'll stay true to your word to Father Jacob and continue the compassion you showed Grandfather Abraham. Everything you promised our ancestors from a long time ago. Promise of God to bring healing and hope. Guys, what I've tried to describe to you through that tension is what God takes care of in what he calls a covenant relationship. covenant relationship. So we've got to remember that this relationship of a covenant is how God relates to us. A solemn and binding yet highly personal and intimate relationship. Both parties swear. They put their hand on the Bible, so to speak, raise their right hand and swear to faithfulness to the other. And yet the history recorded in the Bible is an account of individuals and communities continually breaking their promise and obligations to God. He keeps requiring obedience, and yet even in the midst of failure, God remains faithful. He forgives and he restores. Now I want you to turn over to Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah 31, starting with verse 31. That's right. The time is coming when I will make a brand new covenant with Israel and Judah. It won't be a repeat of the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took their hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant even though I did my part as their master. They just couldn't keep up their end of the deal. They never stayed obedient. They were irresponsible. They took advantage. They complained. And then God said, I'm going to give them a brand new covenant. This is the brand new covenant that I will make with Israel when the time comes. I will put my law within them. Right there. Or in Jewish circles, right here. Because the center of a man in Jewish culture was his gut, his belly, right here, right in your gut. Jesus lives here. Jesus lives right here in the new covenant. Write it on their hearts and be their God, and they will be my people. They will no longer go around setting up schools to teach each other about God. They'll know me firsthand, the dull and the bright, the smart and the slow. I'll wipe the slate clean for each of them. I'll forget they ever sinned. Because that's the hope of the gospel. That's the beauty, that he puts a whole new heart in us through the blood of Jesus. That's the covenant. Jesus is the Lamb. When God established a covenant, he took a goat, a lamb, walked through the middle of it, a calf, whatever the instrument was, and it was like the covenant, the blood of the animal made that covenant secure. And Jesus is the sacrificial lamb that makes the new covenant possible. And he takes care of both the love of God being expressed to us, but also takes care of our failure to be obedient. He requires us to be holy. And then even in our feeble attempt, in our inability to fulfill that fully, he covers it. That's amazing. He does your part and my part in a certain sense, but he continues to require us to be faithful. So this great tension is in your covenant relationship with God, or is your covenant relationship with God conditional based on his love for you? In the end, will his holiness and justice be more fundamental than his love and mercy, or will it be the other way around? Will he punish you or forgive you? In Exodus 34 that we just read expresses this mystery, the great tension between what he requires and yet what he does. God provides. Our only hope of truly being in an intimate relationship with God is to see that he requires something that we can't meet, perfect holiness, and then he says, got you covered. And then out of that work that he's done, we're obedient to him out of gratitude, not trying to get his approval. If you're trying to be obedient to God to gain his approval, you're in big trouble. It will never work. It's like, I know who wins the game. And I enjoy playing the game because I'm relaxed. I know how this turns out. God wins. God wins. The resolution. Turn over to Galatians chapter 3. I want you to be saturated in God's word this morning. Galatians chapter 3. Listen to this. Just the fulfillment of all that God had promised in the Old Testament. Starting with verse 9, Galatians 3. So those now who live by faith are blessed along with Abraham who lived by faith. This is no new doctrine, and that means that anyone who tries to live by his own effort, independent of God, is doomed to failure. Jesus said it well in John 15, you can do nothing, nothing when you're separated from me. Scripture backs this up. Utterly cursed is every person who fails to carry out every detail written by the book of law. You have no hope to carry out every detail of the law. That's impossible. The obvious impossibility of carrying out such a moral program should make it plain that no one can sustain a relationship with God that way. The person who lives in right relationship with God does it by embracing what God arranges for him. Doing things for God is the opposite of entering into what God does for you. Habakkuk had it right. Quote, the person who believes God is set right by God. And that's the real life. That's the gospel. God said it. I believe it. I trust his promises. I put my faith in his promises. That's the gospel. Rule keeping does not naturally evolve into living by faith, but only perpetuates itself in more and more rule keeping. A fact observed in Scripture, the one who does these things, rule keeping, continues to live by them. Ever met somebody who's rigid, who can't be satisfied, who is continually disappointed, who tends to be critical and blamey? Welcome. Glad you're here. We're going to show you a new way, a better way. Christ redeemed us from self-defeating, cursed life by absorbing it completely into himself. Do you remember the scripture that says, quote, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, unquote. This is what happened when Jesus was nailed to the cross. He became a curse and at the same time dissolved the curse. And now because of that, the air is cleared and we can see that Abraham's blessing is present and available for non-Jews too. We are all able to receive God's life, his spirit in and with us by believing just the way Abraham believed it, received it. Can you imagine being a Jewish person and hearing this? Wow. It's not about being a bloodline into Abraham. It's about believing what God has done through Jesus. Every day, in order to be in intimate relationship with God, I need to understand what's happened through Jesus. Every day to love my wife better, to love my two girls better, to love you better, to love men who come into my presence, who love men and women who come into my counseling office, I need to be anchored in the grace and mercy of God, because I can't make it happen. You can't make it happen. I'm going to show you a clip out of the Green Mile. I've shown you several clips the last several weeks. This is a very sad clip to me because Tom Hanks's character, I think his name is Gary. Gary continues to struggle some 60 years before with the execution of John Coffey. He knows an innocent man died that day in the electric chair, and he's wrestled with it. He's in a nursing home, and he's trying to reconcile what happened. This scene is not a redemptive scene. This scene, to me, is very troubling because Gary is trying to reconcile that without the gospel. I so much want to jump into this video clip and sit down with a cup of coffee with Gary and share the gospel with him. Gary, There's hope, even for John Coffey. I think John Coffey went to heaven that day. That's the way I hear the story. I think he understood, and he kept talking heaven, heaven, as he was executed. But Gary, he has no hope. So sad. We all heard the news yesterday. Aaron Hernandez, great athlete, promising future. Oh, my goodness. Just through some crazy set of circumstances, you know, his life went all off track. And he killed himself a couple days ago. And I heard this morning on the news that before he hanged himself in his jail cell, he wrote John 3:16 on his forehead. Did you hear that? John 3:16. I hope Aaron Hernandez really understood the gospel. And I hope he's in heaven with John Coffey. I want you to watch this scene.
I'm 108 years old, Elaine. I was 44 the year that John Coffey walked 3 miles. He mustn't blame John. He couldn't help what happened. It was, he's just a force of nature. Oh, I've lived to see some amazing things, Ellie. Another century come to pass. But I've had to see my friends and loved ones die off through the years. Hal and Melinda, Brutus Hal, my wife, my boy. And you, Elaine, you'll die too. And my curse is knowing that I'll be there to see it. It's my atonement, you see. It's my punishment for letting John Coffey ride the lightning, for killing a miracle of God.
Almighty everlasting God, source of all being and life.
You'll be gone like all the others. I'll have to stay. I'll die eventually, that I'm sure. I have no illusions of immortality, but I will have wished for death long before death finds me. In truth, I wish for it already.
I wonder why you keep
me away. Mr. Jingles? Where you been?
Been worried about you, boy. You hungry? Let's go see if we can't find you something to eat. A few crumbs, anyway. You like that? What are you?
I lie in bed most nights thinking about it. And I wait. I think about all the people I've loved now long gone. I think about my beautiful Jen, how I lost her so many years ago. And I think about all of us walking our own green mile, each in our own time. But one thought, more than any other, keeps me awake most nights. If he could make a mouse live so long, how much longer do I have? We each owe a death. There are no exceptions. But oh God, sometimes the green mile seems so long.
Oh, death, where is your sting? Jesus has risen. Guys, there is no way to have hope in this life apart from the gospel. Our hope for eternal life and to reconcile all of the hurts and pains that you're going through now and have gone through and have caused are swallowed up in the gospel. And our life is but a flash, but a minute, but a speck on a line of eternity, a dot. It is a beautiful thing to understand the forgiveness of God and the standard of holiness to which he holds us to, and then covers us by his son's blood. That is amazing. Guys, self-examination and repentance is something that we need to be doing regularly, not to earn God's favor, because that, again, is covered by the gospel. But my goodness, what he has done for us elicits self-examination. How am I hurting somebody? How am I, when my good friend Joe Barlow walks into my presence, how am I not welcoming him? What right do I have to hold anger and bitterness and not receive somebody with a welcome? I'm just glad I'm here. Self-examination through a biblical standard. Now listen, what would it be like if you and I daily took just this one passage, Galatians chapter 5, and just evaluated ourselves by it? You pray through it. Listen to this, Galatians 5. But what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others. I know that God has redeemed me because I have great affection for others. Exuberance about life. Wow, life is so full. I love life. Serenity. Not chaos, just serenity, peace. We develop a willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments. I would even say loyal communities. Not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. What would it be like if you evaluated and examined your life that way? It would be different. George Whitefield had said this. He said, God, give me a deep humility, a well-guided zeal, a burning love, and a single eye, and then let men or devils do their worst. So he was continually evaluating himself. How does humility work in my life? How is my zeal, my energy, my focus, a burning love? Are people saying that I'm growing in love and becoming more welcoming to others? A single eye. We would call that intentionality and deliberateness. Not chaotic. So guys, again, the gospel covers us, offers us a standard of justice that we can't meet, and then offers us a hand of love that says, I've taken it all. I've taken care of it. Wow. If that doesn't bring you to tears at certain moments of your life, you're calloused and hard, and you've missed the boat. I watch a scene like that of a man dying with little or no hope and just saying, how many years do you give me? And he has no hope. He just says, death is coming. That is tragic. That's a horror movie at that point. That's scary. I don't have time to go through these practical pieces on intimacy, but these are the blanks you can fill in. I would invite you to sit with your wife, sit with a friend, and go through these practical pieces to intimacy. Practice boundaries. Understand what your worth is. The need to recover from our woundedness. We're all wounded and broken, and get out of these extremes that our woundedness voice says to us, that we're less than, we're better than, that we live relationally, that we begin to understand what we're feeling. We're recovering the truth or the reality of life, and we're learning how to contain. This couple that I was telling you about earlier, when I sat with Bubba and his wife, you know, helping Bubba to understand, let her talk and you just contain. And I'm telling you, that was so hard for Bubba to do, because he wanted to react. He wanted to defend. He wanted to explain. No. Just listen. Just listen. Guys, I want you to live intimately, knowing and being known, first and foremost with God, and then with each other. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you so much for Jesus, for the gospel. Thank you for the reminder this morning. Thank you for all that you've given us in our daily manna to sustain us today. We'll trust you today and wait for your manna for tomorrow. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.